But you just really never know what's going to happen here at the Lake Viking Church, do you? I'm telling you. If it's not one thing, it's another. And Matty always seems to come up with a joke for somebody, but unfortunately, Randy gets thrown under the bus. Amen. Turn with me, if you would, in your Bibles this morning to 1 Corinthians chapter 2. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, where we're going to start at today. You know, we have so many things going on in the world today that, yes, many of you would almost have to be blind to not see or recognize that, yes, the Lord is coming soon. How soon? We're not exactly sure. I don't care how soon it is. I just want to be ready.
Amen.
Amen. And I think that's what that song alludes to, is that, you know, wait a little longer, please, Jesus. Because every one of us have loved ones that need to be saved and brought back to the kingdom of God. The scriptures say that in the last days there would be a great falling away. And you know, I was even listening to a radio program that was talking about how that churches today, there are so many churches who are just fading away because the people aren't going to church. But we need to come to church because we are a family. We are the family of God. And as that we are the family of God, we need one another. Amen. That's why we treat one another around here, you know, with such dignity as well as humility at times. Amen. Because, you know, we love one another with the love of Jesus Christ as that He has commanded us to do. This morning's message is actually the hidden things of God. You know, there are a lot of things that people maybe think that they know or think that they understand, but yet in all reality, it's the simplicity things of the gospel that we really need to understand that are still hidden from a lot of people because they choose not to search or seek after God. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, starting in verse 1, says, "And I, brethren, when I came unto you, I came not with excellency of speech or of wisdom, declaring unto you the testimony of God. For I determined not to know anything among you, save Jesus Christ and Him crucified. And I was with you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. And my speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of men's wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power. And your faith should, that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God." Let us pray. Father God, as we go through your word this morning, just let it pop to life within our hearts, God. Father, that the depth of our faith, God, might even grow deeper because we put our trust in you. Even as Christian believers, we need to trust you more. And Father, as you pour out more upon your people, God, let us receive what the Spirit has to say to us. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, the Apostle Paul, I wanted to tell you this, was schooled by Gamaliel. Gamaliel was a man who was a tremendous teacher. He sat at the feet of Gamaliel and learned in Jerusalem. And as he did, he was growing and he was developing. And Paul was really a very eloquent man in his speech. He could talk to the lowest of the low, but he could also speak to the intellectual in such a way that he almost lost them at times because of his learning ability and the depth of his understanding. But here we see this morning to where that it says, "For I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and Him crucified." You see, we as the Christian believers today, we make things so hard for people. But it is really the simplicity of the gospel in which that we need to know and understand. For what does it profit a man if he gains the whole world, but yet loses his own soul? So Paul brought it down, even though he had room for boasting, he really didn't want to. He says in verse 3, "And I was with you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling, and my speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of men's wisdom." Even if you just stop right there, it wasn't because there is a men's or man's wisdom, but yet it's not the wisdom of God. And Paul was not using that. He was using, as it says here, "but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, the power of the Holy Spirit, that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God." That's where we need to be standing today. But unfortunately, there are too many churches and denominations that have compromised the gospel of Jesus Christ just simply to get people in their pews. That is not what we are about here at Lake Viking. We are a Bible-believing church who stand on the Word of God, and we do not want to compromise the Word, because if we begin to compromise God's Word, His blessing cannot continue to pour out upon us the way that He wants to. Do you know God wants to pour His Spirit out upon His people? In Acts and chapter 19, in fact, we just had this week in our Bible study, but I thought how appropriate that this was, because in Acts in chapter 19, Paul, there again, the apostle, as that he was, it says in verse 11, it says, and God brought special miracles through the hands of Paul. Why did God bring special miracles through the hands of Paul? Was because Paul was totally yielded over to the power and the presence of God. He wasn't trying to be somebody for himself. He was just being who he was for Christ. And because of a result of that, it says that there were special miracles. And because of that, in verse 12, it says, so that from his body were brought unto the sick handkerchiefs or aprons, and the diseases departed from them, and the evil spirits went out of them. Paul had so much power and authority that he operated in the Spirit of God, that finally, you know, somebody said, hey, somebody needs prayer. Well, here, just take my handkerchief. I've already prayed over it. It's anointed with oil. In fact, I got a little oil on my shirt right now, Johnny, because we just anointed somebody with oil. And you know what? They would send that out with those. And when it got to the other end, they would take that and put on them. And guess what? People will be healed. Amen. Not only people get healed, there were demons, demonic beings, that just at the presence of Paul's putting on of that handkerchief, man, they left. We're out of here. In fact, there in the book of Acts, I hadn't planned on going on into it, but there's the seven sons of Sceva, and that's what happens. And whenever that those seven sons, well, we know what we're going to do. That guy over there, he's got a demon in him. Let's just go over and cast him out in the name of Jesus in whom Paul preaches. Bad choice. Should not have done that. I'm telling you. Because what happened was, well, they went and they said, we adjure you in the name of Jesus in whom Paul preaches. Guess what? You know what them demons can speak to. They have a voice. And that demon spoke out of that man, and he said, hey, Jesus, I know him. Bad dude, we don't want to mess with him. And Paul, we know him because he knows Jesus. But who are you? Who do you think you are coming to me speaking this here? Because you're nobody. And that demon that was in that man, them seven sons of Sceva, he beat them up, man. He put them to shame. He even stripped them down and then sent them out naked. Shamefully is what happened. I hadn't planned on talking about all that. Of course, there again. Praise the Lord. But Paul had this authority. Yes, Mark, we may have some entertainment today as well. Praise God. Mark, I got to tell this story. Mark, the other day, well, just yesterday, him and Stephanie will sometimes drive by and say, hey, Pastor, what are you doing? I said, well, I was in the office, and I was preparing. I was studying. I was getting ready for this morning. He says, you mean, why don't you just get up and just go off the cuff or something like that? And I said, is that really what you want me to do? And he said, well, it'll probably be pretty entertaining. I said, you know what? I think I'm going to keep studying and being prepared. Amen. Back to the message. But Paul did not come with the words of wisdom of men, but he came in the demonstration of the Spirit and of power and the wisdom of God, or the power of God as well. Moving on into verse 6 of 1 Corinthians chapter 2. Howbeit we speak wisdom among them that are perfect, yet not the wisdom of this world, nor the princes of this world that come to naught, but we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery. Wow, everybody likes a mystery. They have all kinds of mystery novels. We should read the Bible more. Even with the hidden mystery or hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory, which none of the princes of this world knew, get this, none of the princes, none of those that were in authority at that time knew or even understood, for had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. Do you realize if they would have known and understood, they would not have taken Jesus and hung him on a cross because they were fulfilling prophecy. They were ignorant of that, even though they were so wise in this world. They didn't know what that God was going to do. But I'm telling you, when he did, he defeated death, hell, and the grave, and he is victorious over them. That's why we can stand in the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ, come hell or high water. You've got to stand in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
You have a place in which that you can call upon because you have put your faith and trust in him.
Amen.
In verse 9 it says, as it is written, I have not seen, nor ear heard, neither hath entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. Do you love God here today? I want you to know that this church is growing and it is going in God. And that's the way we want to continue, because there are people, just as Maddie's song proclaimed, Jesus, just hold on a little longer. Wait just a little longer, please, Jesus. Because there are people who still need touched by the power and the presence of God and who need salvation. We're having a baptism service today, not because of what this church has done, but because of what Jesus has done in their lives. If we begin to think that we are doing something individually, guess what? Look again. God may humble us. I want to stay humble to where he doesn't have to humble us. I want to continue to see the power of God move in people's lives. I want to continue to see us love one another, because when the world sees that type of love, guess what? They don't know what you have, but they want it. Amen. I don't know what you have, but I want it. Unfortunately, there's too many places to where that all we get is religion instead of the relationship that we need to have with God. But Paul had that type of a relationship, and this was actually a quote out of the Old Testament, which says, for as it is written, I have not seen nor ear heard, neither hath entered into the heart of man the things that God hath prepared for them that love him. But when you move on into verse 9, it says, but, pause for posture, but God hath revealed them unto us by his Spirit, for the Spirit searcheth the things, yea, the deep things of God. So through the Spirit of God, he has revealed certain things to us that others, that it may still be hid to them, has been revealed to us in his Son. In Romans in chapter 11 and verse 33, I was only going to use this one verse here, to where that it says, oh, the depths and the riches both of the wisdom and the knowledge of God, how unsearchable are his judgments and his ways past finding out. Well, whenever that we have the Spirit of God, he begins to reveal these things to us according to his Spirit, according to his Word. That is why it is so important as a Bible-believing church that we stick to what the Scriptures say. We don't add to it. We don't take away from it. But if it says it, we believe it. We believe it. There are churches who don't believe parts of the Bible. Oh, well, that's not for today. Yeah, it is. You can argue with me all you want about that, but it's still for today. You choose to not receive and believe. But it is still for today, the things that are in this. Verse 11, for what man knoweth the things of a man save the spirit of man, small s, which is in him? Even so the things of God knoweth no man but the Spirit of God. Big S. That's the Spirit of God. That's why it's so important, as it goes on here in verse 12. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of God, which things also we speak, not in the words which men's wisdom teacheth, but which the Holy Ghost teacheth, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. Do you know the world knows nothing about the spirituality of God? Oh, it has an idea of spirituality, but yet, you know what? God is the truth. The devil is a liar. And I want you to know the devil has a counterfeit to everything that God has that's good. The devil's trying to deceive you by his counterfeit. That's why it is so important that we stick to the Scriptures. Even as Brother John was mentioning this morning about some of the things that are going on in the world today, we need to love those individuals. But we also need to be wise, as the Scripture says, to be as wise as a serpent, but yet as harmless as a dove. Because I want you to know that God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe upon Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. That's everybody. I don't care how deep or how dark that you've been into sin, God wants to save you. He sent His Son to pay the price for your sin on the cross of Calvary. Yes, we talk about sin in this church. We talk about how that we need to repent from those sins and ask God to forgive us and heal us and bring us into His presence to where that we are operating in the way that God originally wanted us to, in His freedom, in His liberty, because He has given us those through Christ Jesus. But unfortunately, too many people, I heard it was Adrian Rogers this week on the radio, and I thought, oh, this is so good, I've got to remember this one. It says, do you know why that some people can't find God? Is because it's like a robber that can't find a police officer. They don't want to. Because they want their way, not God's way. And you see, I would rather have God's way in my life and have eternal life through His Son than to have my own will, because God will allow you to have your own will, you see. He'll give you that freedom, because you see, there's freedom that we have in Christ. When you come to this church here, I've told almost everybody, if not everybody, that has walked through those doors that has had any potential of wanting to be a part of this church, you need to feel free to come. We want you to feel free to come to this church. But on the flip side of that coin is this. You need to have the freedom to leave as well. Because if you don't have the freedom to leave, you are operating in a way that is not godly. Because I'm not here to hold you. I'm not here to keep you. I'm here to lead and to guide you as a shepherd for the Lord. But yet when God leads people on, I have to allow that to happen as well. And I will love you and I will bless you as that you go. And I've had to do that in the past with certain people in certain ways. Some people move on. Some people go on. But I know preachers, it's like, oh no, you can't leave. This is your church. This is where you're supposed to be. But it's like, yeah, but God's calling me to move somewhere else. And it's like, oh no, He can't. You got to be here. You know, I look at Jim and Marilyn. They moved here because this is where God sent them to Lake Viking, okay? They had no idea that this church was even here. But when they came, wow, I had no clue that this church was even here like this. But how much of a blessing has it been? Because God sent them here. And if it's ever time that God may move them somewhere else, then they have that blessing to do. But the freedom that we must feel is a freedom in the Lord. But I believe in church commitment. I believe in being committed to a congregation, because we need each other, and the growing times that we are living in, I want to tell you something, we are going to need each other more. Brother, every time I see you and your family come, you can't be here every week because you live in the city, but when you come, we make connection, don't we? Because we are brothers in Christ. Because we have a connection in the Lord that is something that you can't see, but you can feel it. You can know it's there because it touches us, because it moves our hearts, because we believe the same thing. We believe the Bible. Amen. I love that. Oh, yes, the answer's on the way. This I know. My Jesus said it. I believe it, and it's so. My Heavenly Father knows the need before we pray. And you can rest assured the answer's on. I think you should sing that with me. Oh, yes, the answer's on the way, this I know. My Jesus said it, I believe it, and it's so. My Heavenly Father knows the need before we pray. And you can rest assured the answer's on the way. Back to the Scriptures here in verse 13. Which things also we speak, not in the words which men's wisdom teach, but the which the Holy Ghost teacheth, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. But the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him, neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. But you know, there are people sometimes that go to church, and they look at that little weird preacher up behind the pulpit, and they think, that guy's nuts. Man, what's he talking about? It's because they're using their natural mind and trying to understand. I don't get this. But when the Spirit of God gets a hold of you, and all of a sudden you begin to now I get it. Now I understand what that little weird preacher's talking about. I may still be weird, but that's okay. I'm getting my point across. Because the natural man, or that man that operates in the natural world, he can't understand. It takes the Spirit of God to be able to understand. Because they are spiritually discerned. But he that is spiritually judgeth all things, yet he himself is judged of no man. For who hath known the mind of the Lord, that he may instruct him? But we, say that with me, but we have the mind of Christ. But we have the mind of Christ. Turn with me, if you would, to Matthew in chapter 13. And as you're turning there, I'm just going to tell you, this is the story of the sower and the seed, to where Jesus talks about it. But we're not going to go into all of that this morning. I want to get to the point to where that in verse 10, the disciples, it says this, and the disciples came and said unto him, why speakest thou unto them in parables? They were asking, why are you saying all this to them in parables, Jesus? What's going on? He answered and said unto them, because it is given unto you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, but unto them it is not given. Wow, did you know that's why Jesus really spoke to them in parables? Is because for the disciples and for those that were believers and those that were followers, it was given unto them to be able to know and understand. But yet to those others who were outside of the realms and just kind of listening in, they could there again listen to Jesus and say, I don't get it. What's going on here? For whosoever hath, to him shall be given, and he shall have more abundantly. But whosoever hath not, from him shall be taken away, even that he hath. Therefore spake I to them in parables, because they see not, and hearing, they hear not, neither do they understand. Wow. And in them is fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah, which saith, by hearing they shall hear and shall not understand, and seeing ye shall see and shall not perceive. For this people's heart is waxed gross, and their ears are dull of hearing, and their eyes have they closed, lest at any time they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears and should understand with their heart and should be converted, and I should heal them. Do you know this is where that the world is at today? We have gotten so far away from God and even against God. It amazes me to see how hostile people are actually against the gospel, because when you start talking about Jesus, it brings things up inside of them. You can talk about God all day long. But when you mention Jesus, all of a sudden there is power in the name of Jesus. And I'm telling you, the demons know it as well. And so when you start telling them, you know, you need Jesus in your life, he wants to save you, they need to hear that. But there are going to be those that reject that as well. But there's going to be those that receive that. That's why it's so important in how that we deliver the gospel to people, that they know with the sincerity of our hearts that we are doing it out of the aspect and the spirit of love, not out of the aspect of condemnation. I mentioned it this morning in Sunday school. I said, you know, we here at the Lake Viking Church, I said, I love people. We want everybody that walks through those doors to be loved and to feel loved and to sense the presence of God. But yet I don't want them to feel like they're being condemned. I may feel that burden. That burden can be lifted today through, Lord, forgive me. I come to you. I accept what you have for me. But there again, has your heart become so waxed gross or hard? Has your ears become so dull of hearing? And have you closed your eyes? to the truth of the gospel. He wants you to open your eyes to Him today. Moving on into verse 16, it says, "But blessed are your eyes, for they see, and your ears, for they hear. For verily I say unto you, that many prophets and righteous men have desired to see those things which ye see, and have not seen them, and to hear those things which ye hear, and have not heard them." These are the words that Jesus was saying to His disciples, "But blessed are you." Turn with me, if you would, to Colossians in chapter 1, verse 26 through 29. Marilyn, if you would go ahead and come to the piano. Colossians chapter 1. Verse 26 and 27. Actually, through 29, I went ahead and put them all down. "Even the mysteries which have been hid from ages and from generations, but now is made manifest to His saints, to whom God would make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory." Wow. Christ in who? Christ in you, the hope of glory, whom we preach, warning every man and teaching every man in all wisdom, that we may present every man perfect in Christ Jesus, whereunto I also labor, striving according to His workings, which worketh in me mightily. Paul allowed the Spirit of God to work in him mightily. We have those here today who have received this gift. And as if they have received this gift, they are going to be baptized today. And as if they are going to be baptized, I also want to say this, is that Paul also in Romans chapter 1 says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation." After we get through singing our song today, and those that will may come forward to receive Christ, but for those of you who would be baptized today, if you would take this opportunity during the song to come up and be up here with me, I'd just like to ask a little testimony from each one of you, and some of you may have just went, "What? I didn't know I was going to have to say anything." You don't have to say much. I may say it for you. But you shouldn't be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. If we've truly received Jesus, then what do we have to be ashamed about? But we've been made free. And you are here amongst people that love you and care for you and that are so excited for you as that you step into this realm of your personal outward expression of your inward faith that is taking place. Chris.
Established in our presence. At the mention of his name, walls crumble and lives are changed. In the midst of life's temptation, he's there to see us through. This man of which I speak, he's here today for you and me. His name is Jesus, and you can call him as you please. They call him Emmanuel, the King of all kings. He's the Son of the Father, the Prince of Peace. They call him Hosanna, the lighthouse at sea, the Rock of Ages. He's a friend to me. Many times I call his name, prayed for forgiveness when used in vain. All the prayers for peace and knowing his forgiveness, it stays the same. Most famous for his story, things he spoke. His name is Jesus, but you can call him when you please. They call him Emmanuel, the King of all kings. He's the Son of the Father, the Prince of Peace. They call him Hosanna, the lighthouse at sea, the Rock of Ages. He's a friend to me. The Rock of Ages. He's a friend to me.
And it's, Johnny and I thought that it was really a God thing that I would happen to choose this song to sing today. But it's wait a little longer, please, Jesus. Here the labor is so hard, and the workers are so tired, and our weary hearts are yearning for rest. And we find we're getting anxious to be in a happy land where we receive such peace and happiness. But wait a little longer, please, Jesus. There are so many wandering out in sin. Just a little longer, please, Jesus. A few more days to We may look into the skies and tears will fill our eyes and our burdened hearts grow heavier with each day. Then we cry, oh Lord, please come, come and take your children home. But we look around and suddenly we say, wait a little longer, please, Jesus. There are so many wandering out in sin. Just a little longer, please, Jesus. A few more days to get our loved ones in. The family scattered everywhere. And Lord, we love them dear, and maybe we can help them find a way. And if weight is the cause that they might not be lost, then that's the only reason why we say, wait a little longer, please, Jesus. There are so many wandering out in sin. Just a little longer, please, Jesus. A few more days to get our loved ones in. Wait a little longer, please, Jesus. There are so many wandering out in sin. Just a little longer, please, Jesus. A few more days to get our loved ones in. Just a few more days to get our loved ones in.